Hi, this is Tamya Ravindran and welcome back to my channel Infinity for UPSC. So today we are going to cover the second half of this chapter, which is discussing about the Cholas. A closer look at Cholas. So this is the map which has been given in your textbook, and this is the Chola Empire. And the title of this map is From Urayur to Tanjavur. I'll be explaining the reason behind this title, but after some time. As of now, just pay attention to these two terms, from Urayur to Tanjavur, and note the locations. This is Urayur and this is Tanjavur. Now before proceeding, I think we should revise every single statement which has been discussed about Cholas till date. That is, from chapter 1 to chapter 11 of ancient history, if we had discussed anything about Cholas, we will have to revise it here before we proceed to this chapter. So what have we learnt about Cholas till date? Now there is one more point that you have to note related to Chola Empire. That is, they had ruled for two different time periods. One was the post-Mauryan Empire Cholas, and the second Chola Empire is what we are going to cover in this chapter. So let us see what have we covered till now. So the first Chola Empire was the post-Mauryan Empire. We had seen that the Mauryan Empire collapsed about 2200 years ago, which means 200 BC. And after 200 BC, we had several post-Mauryan empires. And one of those post-Mauryan empires was the Chola Empire. So let us see what were the post-Mauryan empires. We had Indo-Greeks, Shakhas, Kushanas, then Shungas, Kanvas, Satavahanas, Vakatakas. Then in the South India, we had the Cholas, Cheras and Pandyas. And these three kingdoms, they ruled from 200 BC to 200 AD. Now there is one more statement which is given here, and this says the Pallavas and Chalukyas, they ruled about 1500 years ago, which means about 500 AD. Now this has also been categorized under post-Mauryan Empire, but these two are not post-Mauryan Empire. They came into existence in 500 AD, and this was the time period of Guptas. That is, towards the end of Gupta period, the Pallavas and Chalukyas came into existence. So you can consider these two kingdoms as post-Gupta period kingdoms and not post-Mauryan kingdoms. So we revise that the first Cholas which we had learned, that was a post-Mauryan empire which ruled from 200 BC to 200 AD. So these are the post-Mauryan kingdoms. This is a list, and note that this is not in order because all these kingdoms had ruled different areas, somewhere in the north, somewhere in the south, somewhere in the central region. So this is not in the correct order of their arrival. Just note the kingdoms. So that was one thing, that the first Cholas were the post-Mauryan kingdom and the time period was 200 BC to 200 AD. Second thing which we had discussed was the Cholas, Cheras and Pandyas, they had two centers of power, and one was inland and one was on the coast. And Puhar or Kaveri Patnam, this was the port of Cholas, that is the earlier Cholas. So Puhar or Kaveri Patnam, this is a place which is related to the early Cholas. Then another important point is Kaveri was the most fertile region in the south, and these three kingdoms, that is Chola, Chera and Pandya, they were trying to control the Kaveri region. And we find that even the later Cholas, they were also trying to control the Kaveri region, and ultimately they occupy the Kaveri Delta region. So this is another important point. Then the third point is Sangam poems mention the Movendar. So Movendar is a term which is associated with Chola, Chera and Pandya. Movendar means three kings. Moonu means three and Vendar means kings. So Movendar, three kings. And another term is Sangam poems. So lot of information about Cholas have been received from Sangam literature. So Sangam poems, Kaveri Delta, Movendar and Puhar or Kaveri Patnam. So this is what you have to take from this slide. And this is the location of Puhar, and this is a region which was ruled by Cholas, this is a region which was ruled by Pandyas, and this by Cheras. Then next, we learnt that the Movendars did not collect regular taxes. Very important statement. The first Cholas, the initial Cholas, they did not collect regular taxes. But instead of collecting taxes, they were receiving gifts, and they also went on military expeditions. And whatever they could collect as gifts or tribute, that was distributed among their supporters, and something was kept for themselves, that is for the kingdom. And this information we get from the Sangam collection. Then we also saw that the Pallavas and Chalukyas gave way to new rulers belonging to Rashtrakutas and Chola dynasties. That is, initial Cholas, they were replaced by Pallavas. And the Pallavas, they were replaced by the later Cholas. So this is the later Cholas. And Chalukyas, they were replaced by Rashtrakutas. So initially Cholas, then Pallavas, then again Cholas. And here Chalukyas and then Rashtrakutas. So we'll see in map. So this area, it was under the control of Cholas initially. Then Pallavas controlled this region. Then again Cholas controlled this region. Then coming to the Chalukyas, they ruled this area, but Rashtrakutas took their place, and later Rashtrakutas will be ruling this area. Then this is the timeline which was discussed in the ancient history. Here we saw the post-Mauryan kingdoms and the time period, and we had discussed about Movindas. Then Satavahanas, Kushanas. Here we had not mentioned about all post-Mauryan kingdoms. We had only mentioned about those kingdoms which were discussed in detail. Then we saw that the Gupta period, they existed from 300 AD to 550 AD, that is 320 AD to 550 AD, and towards the end of Gupta period, Chalukyas and Pallavas, they came into existence and they ruled from 500 AD. And after Chalukyas and Pallavas, again Cholas and Rashtrakutas came into existence. Rashtrakutas, they emerged in 750 AD, and the later Cholas, which we are going to discuss today, that was established in the middle of 9th century, that is around 850 AD. So that was the revision. We had discussed every single statement which we had covered about Cholas till date. Now we will see what is mentioned in this chapter. So first of all, how did Cholas rise to power? A minor chiefly family known as Muttarayar held power in the Kaveri Delta. So Muttarayar, they were controlling the Kaveri Delta. And who were Muttarayars? They were subordinate to the Pallava kings of Kanchipuram. So Pallava kings subordinate was Muttarayar, and Muttarayar was controlling the Kaveri Delta. So make sure that this much is clear. Then after that, Vijayalaya, who belonged to the ancient chiefly family of the Cholas. So this statement says that this Vijayalaya is related to the earlier Cholas. And the earlier Cholas and the later Cholas, they have got the same legacy. That is, they belong to the same family. So this Vijayalaya, he was from Urayur. So this is the title of the map. From Urayur to Tanjavur. So now we know why Urayur was mentioned. Because this person, Vijayalaya, he was from Urayur. And he captured the delta from the Muttarayar in the middle of the 9th century, that is about 850 AD. So Pallava kings, their subordinate Muttarayar, and Muttarayar, they were controlling the Kaveri Delta. But Vijayalaya, who is related to the earlier Cholas and he was from Urayur, he ultimately captured the Kaveri Delta region. And after capturing the Kaveri Delta, he built the town of Tanjavur. So now we know why the title says from Urayur to Tanjavur. Because initially he was a person from Urayur who was nothing or nobody. But ultimately he captured the place and he built the town. And the town is called Tanjavur. That is, his journey starts from Urayur to Tanjavur. And after building the town of Tanjavur, he built a temple for goddess Nishumba Sudini there. So note these places, he built the town of Tanjavur and he also built the temple for goddess Nishumba Sudini. Then the successors of Vijayalaya, they conquered neighboring regions and the kingdom grew in size and power. So that means Vijayalaya, he started with capturing the Kaveri Delta, and Tanjavur was the place which he had built. But the successors of Vijayalaya, they conquered the north and the south region, and ultimately the kingdom grew in size and in power. So who was there in the south and who was there in the north? In the south we had Pandyas and in the north we had Pallavas. So the order is first Pandyas to the south, then Cholas, then Pallavas. So this is the order. Now I am mentioning the order in the geographical map because those kind of questions are frequently asked. So to the extreme south we have Pandyas, then Cholas, then Pallavas. So note this order. So here, note all the important things. Muttarayar, Kaveri Delta, subordinate to Pallava kings. Vijayalaya from Urayur, captured Tanjavur, built the temple. And after that, they also conquered the Pandyan and Pallava territories. Then the next king who had an important role in building Chola Empire was Rajaraja I. The first king which we had learned about was Vijayalaya Chola. Second is Rajaraja I. And he is considered the most powerful Chola ruler. He became king in 985 AD and expanded control over most of these areas. That means he had controlled most of these areas which were under the control of Cholas. And note the time period. It is 985 AD. And the time period of Vijayalaya was 850 AD. That is almost one century later, Rajaraja I came into existence. Then Rajaraja I, he also organized the administration of the empire. So he had a huge role in consolidating the empire and reorganizing the administration of the empire. Then the third important king is Rajaraja's son, Rajendra I. He continued his policies, that is, he continued the policies which were adopted by Rajaraja I, and he even raided the Ganga Valley, Sri Lanka and countries of Southeast Asia, developing a navy for these expeditions. So why is this person very important? Because being in South, he had controlled areas in North, that is the Ganga Valley, then Sri Lanka and countries of Southeast Asia, that is countries which are lying this side. And how did he do that? With the help of navy. So he had a strong naval system, and with the help of this naval system, he had controlled these regions. And you also need to note one more thing, that very few kings from South had controlled some of the other regions in the North. And Rajendra I was one such person, and that is the reason he becomes so very important. So he had controlled Ganga Valley, Sri Lanka and Southeast Asia, and he had a strong naval system. Very important. All these statements are very important. The next is splendid temples and bronze sculpture. We know that Tamil Nadu is very famous for temples, and they have got huge and elaborate temples. And Chola Empire, they have got a huge role in building those temples. The big temples of Tanjavur and Gangaikonda Cholapuram, built by Rajaraja and Rajendra, are architectural and sculptural marvels. Now Tanjavur, this was the town which was built by Rajaraja. And Gangaikonda Cholapuram, here the temple was built by Rajendra, and this was named to celebrate the victory over Ganga Valley. And that is the reason he had named it as Gangaikonda Cholapuram. So Tanjavur, Rajaraja, Gangaikonda Cholapuram, Rajendra I. Next, Chola temples often became the nuclei of settlements which grew around them. That is, once a temple was built by the Cholas, people started settling around the temple, and that became a temple town itself. And the people who were staying nearby these temples, they all were doing some or the other work which was related to temple, which had something to do with temples. So they were into craft production, and all the specialists who worked at the temple, that is the priest, garland makers, cooks, sweepers, musicians, dancers, all these people stayed around the temple, and that entire place became a temple town. And that is the reason we are saying that it became the nuclei of settlement. Temples were also endowed with land by rulers as well as by others. That is, land was gifted to the temple. And the produce of this land went into maintaining all the specialists who worked at the temple and very often lived near it. That is, the livelihood of all these people who are staying nearby the temple, it was dependent on the produce of this land which was gifted to temple. So that is how their livelihood was taken care of. In other words, temples were not only places of worship, they were the hub of economic, social and cultural life. Economic aspect we had already seen, they worked for the temple and their livelihood depended on the produce of the land. Then social and cultural life, because the entire life is revolved around the temple. So that is the reason economic, social and cultural life revolves around the hub of the temple. Then amongst the crafts associated with temples, the making of bronze images was the most distinctive. Chola bronze images are considered among the finest in the world. Very important statement. If you get this statement, do not think that this is a very extreme statement and this could be a wrong one. This is a correct statement. Chola bronze images are considered among the finest in the world. True statement. Most images were of deities, and sometimes images were made of devotees as well. So Chola bronze images, this had images of deities as well as devotees. Now this is the temple at Gangaikonda Cholapuram, built by Rajendra I, and it was built after capturing the Ganga Valley. and this temple is built of stone. So note this, it is built of stone. This is the image of Chola bronze sculpture. Then after discussing temples, which is very important with respect to Chola Empire, we have to discuss agriculture and irrigation. Now why is agriculture and irrigation so important? Because many of the achievements of Cholas were made possible through new developments in agriculture. So the achievements of Cholas were some or the other way dependent on the agriculture. So that makes agriculture topic very important with respect to Cholas. Now why was agriculture so successful? Because the Cholas were controlling the Kaveri Delta region. Now a delta is different from a river. What is the difference? Now this is how the river looks like. That is, you have a water body which is of single channel. This is a single channel water body, and adjacent to this we have land. But if you look at delta, you will see that this single channel river, this splits into several channels. So this is the sea. Before moving into sea, they will separate, they will branch out into several small channels. And ultimately, this land will become very marshy. You also need to note one more thing, that here there is a clear bifurcation between water and between land. But here there is no such bifurcation, because there are water bodies all along. This entire land would be marshy. So the land would be soil plus water. So marshy land, which is very good for agriculture. Here irrigation is very easily possible. If you dig well here, the level of water will be very high. And there are many other things which you could do with respect to irrigation. So irrigation is possible and the land is very fit for agriculture. Then another thing that you need to note is deltas are often formed at the end of the river. That is the region where the river is going to drain into the sea. And that area you will have delta, which is very good for agriculture and irrigation. And since Cholas controlled the delta region, they were very successful in terms of agriculture and irrigation, and they prospered. Then one more thing which is to be noted here is, whenever these channels overflow in the sense when the water flows outside the channel is depositing fine silt on the land. Now whenever a river is flowing, it carries sediments and fine silt with it. And the large sediments are deposited initially, but the river carries with it the fine silt. And that fine silt is carried with the river and it is deposited in the sea. But in case the river overflows, that is, if this region overflows, the silt would be deposited on the land, that is, the adjacent land of the channel. So here you will have fine soil, which is the topsoil. Now, whenever river is flowing, it is carrying with it the topsoil. And the topsoil is very good in terms of nutrients. So here, the topsoil, which is very fine, which is like silt, that would be deposited here. So here you have got water, here you have got topsoil. So in every aspect, this region is extremely good for agriculture and irrigation. Then the next thing which is given here is, this land was very good for rice cultivation. If you had ever seen a paddy field, you would note that the field is filled with water. So on top of that water filled land, you have got rice saplings. So this land is very good for the cultivation of rice. Then, although agriculture had developed earlier in other parts of Tamil Nadu, it was only from 5th or 6th century that this area was opened up for large scale cultivation. That is, before the Cholas came into existence, before the new Cholas came into existence in 850 AD, large scale cultivation had already started in Tamil Nadu. But what was the role of Cholas? They cleared forest for agricultural land, and the land was leveled so that agriculture could be done, because for agriculture you need a flat land. Then in the delta region, embankments were built and canals were also constructed. So that means although large scale cultivation was in existence, Cholas had done much more than that, like clearing forest, leveling the land and building embankments and canals. Then in many areas, two crops were grown in a year. So if you are growing two crops in a year, that means the produce is double. In many cases, it was necessary to water crops artificially, and we know that they had built canals and irrigation system was in place. So they could water the crops artificially as well. A variety of methods were used for irrigation. In some areas, wells were dug Then huge tanks were constructed. Then they were collecting rainwater. So all the things which are necessary for a good agricultural system was done by the Cholas. Remember that irrigation work requires planning, like organizing labor and resources, maintaining these work and deciding on how water is to be shared. That means Cholas had invested their time, money and all sort of resources in making sure that their agricultural system and irrigation system was very good and everything was in place. And along with the rulers, the people living in villages, they also took an active interest in these areas. So it was not just the rulers, it was the people living in villages also who had contributed to the development of the agriculture and irrigation of the Cholas. And that made Cholas very rich and prosperous. This is a sluice gate which was built in Tamil Nadu in the 9th century. Now, what is the purpose of a sluice gate? It regulates the outflow of water from a tank into the channels that irrigated the field. So from here, when water is supplied to the field, the regulation of water is done by this sluice gate. A sluice gate is a wood or metal barrier which is commonly used to control water level and flow rate in rivers and canals. So the sluice gate that we saw just now, it is one of the methods which was used for irrigation. Now, after irrigation and agriculture, the next thing that we have to study with respect to Cholas is the administration of the empire. Settlement of peasants known as Oor became prosperous with the spread of irrigation and agriculture. So the administration of empire means the empire would be divided into small segments. So one such segment is Oor. And what is a Oor? Oor means settlement of peasants. So peasants live in Oor. And the literal meaning of Oor is village. Oor means village and village of peasants. So note this term, very important. Groups of such villages formed larger units called Nadu. So group of Oors form Nadu. So first Oor and above that we have got Nadu. The village council and the Nadu performed several administrative functions including dispensing justice and collecting taxes. So since this Nadu is a larger unit, this Nadu plus the village council both together would be performing the several administrative functions like dispensing justice and collecting taxes. Now this Nadu and the village council both are governing bodies. That is, these are not people. So who are the people who would be taking care of dispensing justice and collecting taxes? They are the rich peasants of the Vellala caste. So these rich peasants of the Vellala caste, they exercise considerable control over the affairs of the Nadu and they were supervised by the central Chola government. Now here we had seen that Oor means settlement of peasants. That means only peasants stay in Oor and group of Oors together form Nadu. That means even in a Nadu, you will just have peasants. So if you have got only peasants living in the Nadu, obviously peasants are the people who are going to take care of the affairs of the Nadu. And among the rich peasants are selected. And the rich peasants of the higher caste, which is called Vellala caste. So rich peasants belonging to higher caste, they would take care of the affairs of the Nadu. Then the Chola kings gave some rich landowners titles like Muvenda Velan. Now this is different from Muvendar. We had seen a term called as Muvendar. That is three kings, which are Chola, Chera and Pandya. Now this is Muvenda Velan. So Mu means three, Venda means again king, but Velan means peasant. So it means a peasant who is serving three kings. So do not get confused by these two terms, Muvendar and Muvenda Velan. Then Arayar was another title which was given by Chola kings. Arayar means chief. So note this term, Arayar, chief, and Muvenda Velan, a peasant who is serving three kings. And these two were given to the rich landowners. Then why was this title given? As a mark of respect and since they were entrusted with important offices of the state at the center. So these people occupied important offices and that is the reason they were given high sounding titles like Muvenda Velan and Arayar. So note these terms, Oor, settlement of peasants, larger unit, Nadu, Then rich peasants of the Vellala caste, they took care of the administration of the empire. Then some high sounding titles like Movenda Velan and Arayar, these were given to rich landowners who were also given some important offices. Now when we are discussing all these Ur and Nad in this chapter, do you remember this being discussed earlier? Yes, it was discussed in chapter 10th of class 6. And there we had seen that assemblies in Southern Kingdom. So Southern Kingdom means Chola, Chera, Pandya, Pallava, all these are Southern Kingdoms. And this information, it was given in the inscription of the Pallavas. So that doesn't mean that it is followed only by the Pallava Kingdoms, because the title says assemblies in the Southern Kingdom. So that means it is common for all the kingdoms in the South. And here we saw that Sabha meant assembly of Brahmin landowners. Ur meant village assembly where the landowners were not Brahmins. Then Nagaram, organization of merchants. And Nagaram literally means town. And merchants, they live in towns. So Ur, Sabha and Nagaram, this was discussed earlier. And the meaning is village, Ur is village and the landowners were not Brahmins. Similarly, in this chapter also Ur means village and the place where peasants stay. That means the landowners are not Brahmins. Then Sabha, here this is the assembly of Brahmin landowners. Nagaram, organization of merchants. Then coming back to this chapter, we have seen that Brahmanas often received land grants or Brahmadeya. Very important, Brahmadeya is a term which is associated with the land grant given to the Brahmanas. As a result, large number of Brahmana settlements emerged in the Kaveri Valley as in other parts of South India. So that means whenever land donations are given to Brahmanas, that entire piece of land will have only Brahmins staying there. And many such settlements came into existence because many such grants were given to Brahmanas by different kings and by different kingdoms. So many such Brahmana settlements emerged in Kaveri Valley as well. And each Brahmadeya, that is the land given to Brahmin, was looked after by an assembly or sabha of prominent Brahmin landlords. And here in class 6 also we had seen that Sabha meant an assembly of Brahmin landowners. And in this chapter also we see that Sabha meant an assembly of Brahmin landholders. So the meaning and the terms are same. These assemblies worked very efficiently. The decisions were recorded in detail in inscriptions, often on stone walls of temples. So very important statement, if you get this in your prelims, do not get confused. The decisions were recorded on stone walls of temples. Then after Brahmadeya and Sabha, we have got another term which is Nagaram. And here also the meaning is same. Association of traders known as Nagarams also occasionally performed administrative functions in towns. So Nagaram means towns and here we have got association of traders living. So once again, Brahmadeya, land given to Brahmins. And it was taken care of by assembly or sabha, which consisted of prominent Brahmin landholders. Then Nagaram, it means town and traders live in Nagarams. Then there is an inscription in Uttaramerur and this inscription is called as Uttaramerur inscription. Now what is the importance of this inscription? It gives us details of the way in which sabha was organized. So that means we get information about the way the empire was administered. So what does this inscription say? The Sabha had separate committees to look after irrigation work, garden, temples, etc. That means delegation of work was there. Each work was given to a separate committee. Then names of those eligible to be members of the committee were written on small tickets of palm leaf. These tickets were put into a pot, from which a young boy was asked to take out the tickets one by one for each committee. That means it was through lottery system that each of the members of the committees were selected. And we get this information through Uttaramerur inscription. Then the Uttaramerur inscription also gives us the qualifications which are required to be a member of a sabha. So what are the qualifications? All those who wish to become members of the Sabha should be owners of land from which land revenue is collected. They should have their own homes. That means they should be well off. Then they should be between 35 and 70 years of age. So age limit is there. They should have knowledge of the Vedas. That means the person should be knowledgeable, and this is something which is very much required in present scenario. We do not have many politicians who are educated. So this kind of qualification is required even today. They should be very well versed in administrative matters and honest. Very important criteria. If anyone has been a member of any committee in the last 3 years, he cannot become a member of another committee. Anyone who has not submitted his accounts and those of his relatives cannot contest the election. So they should be well off. Age criteria, knowledge of Vedas, knowledge of administrative matter, honest, and they should have submitted their accounts, and they should not have been a member of any committee in the last 3 years. Then some other Chola inscriptions gives us details about the categories of land. So this is not Uttaramerud inscription, this is some another inscription, and it is giving us details of the types of land. So here basically 5 types of lands are given. The terms and the meaning, both are very important. These kind of questions are frequently asked. Vellan Vagai, land of non-Brahman peasant proprietors. We had already seen that Vellala means a peasant caste. So here peasant who are non-Brahmans. Then Brahmadeya, we had seen land gifted to Brahmins. Shala Bhoga, land for the maintenance of a school. Shala in Marathi, it means school. So Shala Bhoga, land for the maintenance of school. Devadan, land gifted to temple. Now this term is easy, but look at this term. So note this, Tirunamatukani, land gifted to temples. Then Pallichandam, land donated to Jaina institutions. Pallichandam, land donated to Jaina institution. So Vellana Vagai, non-Brahman peasants. Brahmadeya, Brahmins. Shala Bhoga, school. Devadana or Tirunamatukani, land gifted to temples. Pallichandam, Jaina institutions. Now this slide, it was shown in the first part of the chapter. There we had to discuss it because we were covering the land grants and the prashastis. But here I want all the information related to Cholas in one single video. So that is the reason I am covering the previous chapters, previous classes and previous part in this single video. So there we have seen that copper plates have got all the information related to land grant, and this is sealed with a royal seal. So that means this is an authentic document. Then these are the details which are mentioned in the copper plate. That is, when a land is granted, these details are mentioned. So the demarcation of boundary, what the land contains and how can he collect the taxes and on what taxes can be collected, what all things could be built on that land and how water is not to be wasted and what is to be done for that, all these details are mentioned in the land grant. Then this slide was also seen in the previous part, because there we had to discuss the taxes, the resources and what is to be done with that resource. So I am putting it here once again. And as per the Chola inscription, there were 400 taxes, and the most important tax is vetti, which is not collected in cash but in the form of forced labor, kadamai or land revenue. And taxes were collected on thatching the house, use of ladder to climb palm tree, and cess on succession to family property. This is given even today. Next is Periyar Puranam, which is a 12th century Tamil work. That is, it is a book. Till now we had discussed about inscriptions, and till now we had discussed about important people and important aspects. We had discussed about kings, the administration system, the temples, the brahmanas, the land grants and all those aspects. But Periyar Puranam discusses about the ordinary people. It gives us a gist of the life of the ordinary people. How their day-to-day life is, that has been mentioned in this Periyar Puranam. Now all these things you can pause and read if you want. But the statement which is important for your exam is this term called Pulayas. So Pulayas, it was a name used for a social group considered outcast. So Pulayas are outcast people, and they are outcasted by Brahmins and Vellalas. Who are Vellalas? Rich peasants. So they are high caste rich peasants, and they have outcasted these Pulayas. And what are these Pulayas basically? They are agrarian laborers engaged in menial occupation. So this one entire statement is very important for your exam. பெரிய புராணம் 12th century தமிழ் work gives us information about the life of the ordinary people, புலையாஸ் outcast by Brahmins and Villalas, and they are basically agrarian laborers engaged in menial occupation. Next is China under the Tang dynasty. So while India was ruled by the kingdoms like Rashtrakutas, Chahamanas, Gurjar Pratiharas, Palas, Cholas, Cheras, Pandyas, when all these kingdoms were ruling India, what was happening in China? So during that time, China was under the Tang dynasty. And what is the time period that we are referring to in this chapter? It is from 7th to 12th century. So in between that time, China was under the Tang dynasty. And what is the most important statement here? The Tang Empire was administered by a bureaucracy recruited by an examination which was open to all who wished to appear for it. That is, it was an open examination. There was no limitation. Anybody could write the exam and could become part of the administration system. And this system of selecting officials remained in place with some changes till the 20th century. So from 7th century to 20th century, this process was on and there was no limitation. Anybody could write that. And there was no caste-based quota system. That means it is open for all and everybody has got an equal chance of clearing the exam. So I'll just read it once. In China, an empire was established under the Tang dynasty, which remained in power for about 300 years. That is from 7th to 10th century. Its capital, Xi'an, was one of the largest cities in the world, visited by Turks, Iranians, Indians, Japanese and Koreans. So this statement, you can use it for your essays, for your ethics questions and for your society-based questions. So you can mention the Tang Empire and how the system was in place from 7th to 20th century and how it was open for all and how it was a transparent system. Now let us revise this chapter once again. So in this chapter, basically, we are covering the time period from 7th to 12th century. And here in the map, we see Chahamanas, Gurjar Pratiharas, Chandelas, Paramars, then Palas, Rashtrakutas, Cholas, Cheras, Pandyas. And during this time period, we have got new dynasties, that is new kings have come into existence. And who are these new kings? They were the initial big landlords or the warrior kings who had later become Samantas, but whenever they got an opportunity to overthrow the king or whenever they got an opportunity to set up their own independent kingdom, they did so and they became the new kings. So that is how Samantas became the new kings. And these Samantas, they could easily overthrow the king because they had the military power with them and the kings used to share their power and wealth with these Samantas. And these Samantas, they also had high sounding titles like Mahasamanta and Mahamandaleshwara. So they had military strength, they had power, they had wealth and they had high sounding titles. So whenever they got an opportunity, they asserted their independence. Then we saw the example of Rashtrakutas in Deccan, who were the Samantas of Chalukyas of Karnataka. And Dandi Durga, who was a Rashtrakuta chief, he overthrew his Chalukya overlord. And this Dandi Durga, he had even performed a ritual called Hiranyagarbha, which made him a Kshatriya. So this is how Rashtrakutas became king. Then we see other case where people from enterprising families, they had established their kingdoms. And examples are Gurjar Pratiharas and Kadamba Mayura Sharman. And these people, they ruled the Karnataka region and Gurjar Pratiharas, Rajasthan. Then we saw this image which was carved out in Ellora, K15. It is an image of Vishnu as Narasimha and this is a work of Rashtrakuta period. Very important statement. Then we discussed the administration in the kingdom. That is, how did these new kings rule the kingdom? First of all, they adopted high sounding titles because they did not have good legacies behind them. They were new kings and they did not have a good background. But they shared power with their Samantas and also with association of peasants, traders and Brahmins. Very important statement. Then we saw that resources were collected from producers and traders. And this was collected as rent due to lord. Then we saw that these resources were used to finance king's establishment, fight wars, construct temples, construct forts, all these things. And the people who were collecting revenue, they were recruited from influential families and the position was often hereditary. And the positions in army was also hereditary. And I have already told you that this was one of the major reasons why did these new kingdoms collapse. Then these are the dynasties and the region associated with the dynasties. ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರಕೂತ ಡೆಕ್ಕನ್ ಚಾಲುಕ್ಯಾಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಕಡಂಬ ಮಯೂರ ಶರ್ಮನ್ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಗುರ್ಜರ್ ಪ್ರತಿಹಾರ ರಾಜಸ್ಥಾನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಚೋಲಾಸ್ ತಮಿಳ್ನಾಡು ದೆನ್ ವಿ ಡಿಸ್ಕಸ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಪ್ರಶಸ್ತೀಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಗ್ರಾಂಟ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ವಿ ಸಾ ದಿ 12th ಸೆಂಚುರಿ ಲಾಂಗ್ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತ್ ವಿಚ್ ಕಂಟೈನ್ಸ್ ದಿ ಹಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿ ಆಫ್ ಕಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಹೂ ರೂಲ್ಡ್ ಓವರ್ ಕಾಶ್ಮೀರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಕಂಪೋಸ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ಕಲ್ಹಾನಾ ಅಂಡ್ ಕಲ್ಹಾನಾ ಇಸ್ ಅ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಪರ್ಸನಾಲಿಟಿ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ಆಫನ್ ಕ್ರಿಟಿಕಲ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ರೂಲರ್ಸ್ ಆಸ್ ವೆಲ್ ಆಸ್ ದೇರ್ ಪಾಲಿಸೀಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಕಲ್ಹಾನಾ ಹಿ ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ರೆಫರ್ ಟು ಮೆನಿ ಸೋರ್ಸಸ್ ಸೊ ದಟ್ ಹಿಸ್ ವರ್ಕ್ ಇಸ್ ಅಥೆಂಟಿಕ್ Then we saw that whenever a learned Brahman writes prashasti of a ruler, that learned Brahman is gifted land and that land grant is recorded on a copper plate. Then here we saw one example of prashasti which was written in Sanskrit and it was found in Gwalior, Madhya Pradesh. It was written about Nagabhatta who was a Pratihara king. Very important statement, Nagabhatta Pratihara king. Then here you need to know Vidarbha, Maharashtra, Kalinga, Orissa, Vanga, Bengal, Anartha, Gujarat, Vatsa and Matsya, both are kingdoms in North India and Kirat, it is another name for forest people. Then this is the picture of copper plates recording land grant and here we can see the royal seal which indicates that it is an authentic document. Then after discussing the prashastis and land grants, we saw about warfare for wealth. And here we discussed about three struggles. First struggle was between Gurjar Pratiharas, Palas and Rashtrakutas and it was for Kannauj in Ganga Valley. Then the second one was Mahmud of Ghazni of Afghanistan raiding India and targeting Indian temples including Somnath, Gujarat. Then here we also discussed that Mahmud of Ghazni he had entrusted Al-Biruni to write about India and Indians and the book is called Kitabul Hind. It is written in Arabic but they had also consulted Sanskrit scholars. Then the third struggle was between Chahamanas and the adjacent kingdoms. So Chahamanas, who are also called Chauhans, they ruled near Delhi and Ajmer and they had constant struggle with Chalukyas of Gujarat and Gadhawals of western Uttar Pradesh. Then we also saw that the best known Chauhan ruler was Prithviraj III because he had defeated the Afghan ruler called Mahmud Ghori in 1191. But Prithviraj III, he lost to Muhammad Ghori in 1192 and 1192, it is an important period with respect to Indian history. Then once again we revise the ruling dynasties and region. You can pause this slide and read it on your own. Then next, Cholas. So here we had seen this map and here the title was the Chola Kingdom and its neighbors. So that means we are also supposed to have a look at the neighbors. So here we have Kalinga, South Kalinga, Vengi, Pandyas, Kakatiyas, Nolambawadi, Banavasi, Gangavadi, Kadambas, Yadavas and Chalukyas. Now if you look here, it says fluctuating border. That means this is not the fixed boundary of Chola Empire. It keeps on fluctuating. And whenever they lose power over this region, the regional kingdoms take back their power. So here you have got South Kalinga, Vengi, Pandyas, Gangavadi, Nolambawadi, Banavasi, Kakatiyas, Kadambas, Chalukyas and Yadavas. So take a look at all these kingdoms. Then apart from these kingdoms, also take a note of these regions. Here you have got Kanchi, then Gangaikonda Cholapuram, here Urayur, Tanjavur, Madurai, Kalyani and Badami. Kalyani and Badami, these are not part of the Chola Empire, but we also need to have a look at the neighbors. Then the next thing that you need to note is when these Cholas were in existence, that is during the mid of 9th century AD, the Chalukyas were under the control of Vikramaditya VI. So this also you need to note, Vikramaditya VI was the contemporary of the rulers who were ruling the Chola Empire. Then here we have got another title which says from Urayur to Tanjavur and we know the reason because the king Vijayalaya he was from Urayur and ultimately he captured the Kaveri Delta and after capturing the Kaveri Delta he built this city called Tanjavur. Then after that we had revised every single fact about the Cholas which we had learned in class 6 or class 7. So every single fact in order was revised. So the first Chola Empire that was a post-Mauryan kingdom and they ruled from 200 BC to 200 AD. Then we also saw that Sangam poems mention about Muvendra, which means Cholas, Cheras and Pandyas, and each of these kingdoms had two centers of power. One was inland and one was on the coast. And Puhar or Kaveri Patnam, this is the port of Cholas. So Puhar, Kaveri Patnam, port of Cholas. And all these three kingdoms, that is Chola, Chera and Pandya, they were trying to occupy the Kaveri region because Kaveri is the most fertile in the southern part of the subcontinent. Then after that, we saw the location of Puhar. So this is where you have Puhar. Puhar has got another name, which is Kaveri Patnam. And know the places which are adjacent to it. You have got Arikamedu and Mahabalipuram, these two in the north. And then you have got Madurai in the south. And in between, you have got Puhar. Then the most important thing that you need to note about Muvendra is they did not collect regular taxes. And note this, all these things are about the earlier Cholas, not the present Cholas. Present Cholas will be covered after we revise everything about the earlier Cholas. So all these details are about the earlier Cholas, except the first map that we saw. The first map, that is this map, it talks about the second Cholas who ruled during the mid of 9th century. And after that, we were revising all about the earlier Cholas. So all these details are about the earlier Cholas and not the present Cholas or the second Cholas. After that, we saw that Pallavas and Chalukyas, they gave way to new rulers belonging to Rashtrakutas and Chola dynasties. We had Cholas initially, and the first Cholas were replaced by Pallavas, and this Pallava, they were replaced by the second Cholas. So this is the order. First Chola, then Pallava, then Chola. So all these people were occupying the same region. Then this is the location of Pallavas, and they were ruling from Kanchipuram. Then Chalukyas, they were controlling this region, and Aihole is their important center. So Pallavas, Kanchipuram, Aihole, Chalukyas. Then we came to the second Cholas. That is, everything which we are going to cover from here onwards is about the second Cholas who came into existence from 850 AD onwards. That is the middle of 9th century. Now here, what are the important keywords? Muttarayar, Pallava kings of Kanchipuram, Vijayalaya of Urayur, Tanjavur, goddess Nishumba Sudhini. So Muttarayar, they held power in the Kaveri Delta. They were subordinate to Pallava kings of Kanchipuram. And Vijayalaya, who belonged to Urayur, who was nobody during this time period, he captured the delta from Muttarayar. So that is how he captured the Kaveri Delta. And the statement says that Vijayalaya belonged to the ancient chiefly family of Cholas. So that means this Vijayalaya is related to the old Chola family. So both the Cholas have got same legacy. Then Vijayalaya built Tanjavur and a temple for goddess Nishumba Sudhini. Then after Vijayalaya, we had learned about two more kings. One was Rajaraja I. Second was Rajaraja's son Rajendra I. Rajaraja I, he had reorganized the administration. He had expanded control over most of the regions of the Cholas. So Rajaraja I expanded control, reorganized. Then Rajendra I, he raided many places like Ganga Valley, Sri Lanka and countries in Southeast Asia. And all this was possible because of the naval system that he had. So Rajendra I raided different places and he had a strong navy. Then here the important keywords are temples of Tanjavur and Gangaikonda Cholapuram built by Rajaraja and Rajendra. So Tanjavur, this was built by Rajaraja, Gangaikonda Cholapuram built by Rajendra. And this place was named Gangaikonda Cholapuram to celebrate the victory of Rajendra, because he had raided the Ganga Valley in the north, and that is the reason after that raid he named this place as Gangaikonda Cholapuram. Then the next important thing is Chola temples became the nuclei of settlements. Then Chola bronze, it was considered among the finest in the world. Then after that, we came to agriculture and irrigation, and we saw that the major reason for the development of Cholas was agriculture and irrigation. And this was possible because they controlled the Kaveri Delta region. Then we saw that how they paid attention to a variety of irrigation methods and how to water crops artificially, what are the methods they were employing to water crops artificially. So all these things were covered. Then we also saw that apart from kings, people living in villages, they also took an active interest in these activities. Then this is one of the method of watering artificially. It is a sluice gate in Tamil Nadu. Then after agriculture, we came to administration of the empire. And here we saw some terms. One was Ur, second was Nadu, then Arayar, then Movenda Velan. So what are these terms? Ur means settlement of peasants. And several such Ur forms a Nadu. Then Movenda Velan, a Velan or a peasant serving three kings. Arayar, a chief. And these were given to rich landowners as a mark of respect and also because they were occupying important offices of the state. Then rich peasants of Vellala caste, they played an important role in the administration of the empire. Then we also revise that these terms are not new to us. We had already seen in chapter 10 of class 6 and there we saw that inscription of Pallavas mentioned these things. So Sabha, it is an assembly of Brahmin landowners. Then Ur, same village assembly where the landowners were not Brahmins. Nagaram, an organization of merchants. Then we came back to this chapter and here we learned some more terms, that is Brahmadeya. Brahmadeya is the land grant given to Brahmins and each Brahmadeya was looked after by an assembly or sabha. Then association of traders, they lived in towns and it is known as Nagarams. Then we get some more information about the administration of empire from an important inscription. It is called Uttaramerur inscription and it was found in Tamil Nadu. And here we saw that the members of the committees, they were selected by a method of lottery system. Then we saw that the Uttaramerur inscription gives us the qualifications which are required to become a member of the Sabha. So what are the qualifications? They should be wealthy. Then age limit is there. They should have knowledge of Vedas. Then they should be honest. They should have submitted their accounts. And they should not have become member of any of the committees in the last 3 years. Here we saw terms like Vellan Vagai, Brahmadeya, Shala Bhoga, Devdan, Tirunamattukani, then Palli Chandam. So Vellana Vagai, what is it? Land of non-Brahman peasants. Brahmadeya, land gifted to Brahmins. Shala Bhoga, maintenance of school. Then Devadan or Tirunamattukani, land gifted to temples. Palli Chandam, land donated to Jaina institutions. Then here we saw an example of a land grant given by Cholas. So here we get to know what all things are mentioned in a land grant. That is how boundary is demarcated, what does the land contain, how the taxes can be collected and on what all things the taxes can be collected, what can be built on this land, then how water is not to be wasted. So all these things are mentioned in a land grant. Then we saw that in one of the inscriptions of Cholas, 400 taxes were mentioned. And the most frequently mentioned tax was vetti, which is not collected in cash, but in the form of forced labor, kadamai or land revenue. Then we saw 12th century Tamil work, which is called Periya Puranam. And this Periya Puranam, it gives details about the lives of ordinary people. And here we got to learn about Pulayas, who are considered outcast by Brahmins and Vellalas. And who are Pulayas? They are basically agrarian laborers engaged in menial occupation. Then we saw that while Cholas were ruling India, Tang dynasty was ruling China. And the most important statement here is, the Tang Empire was administered by a bureaucracy recruited through an examination which was open to all who wished to appear for it. And this existed till 20th century. This began in 7th century and it existed till 20th century. So that's all from my side. Please like, share and subscribe this channel and I'll be back with the next video very soon. Thank you so much.